Databases are amazing, but running a database can get really expensive really fast, especially if you just want to use it for a small side project. But what if I told you that you can host your database completely for free with a service that you might already use? GitHub has this feature called Guthub Pages, and it allows you to host files and websites right from your GitHub repository. While most people use it to host static pages like open source project websites, personal websites, or even docs pages, I'll show you how you can host an entire database with it. And the best part is, it's completely free. Now, deploying a simple website on GitHub Pages is pretty straightforward. First, we obviously need to create a GitHub repository. And once this is done, you can go into the repository settings, select Pages, and GitHub will automatically suggest a few presets that we can choose from. For now, we can just deploy our entire website as static HTML, and GitHub will automatically create a GitHub action for that. The GitHub action will run every time that we update the repository. So when we create an index.html file and push it to our repository, GitHub will automatically deploy it to our GitHub Pages URL. So now we know how to host a website on GitHub Pages, but how do we host an entire database on there? After all, GitHub only allows us to host static files and does not support any server-side languages. So most traditional databases simply won't work because they need to execute some code on the server and return the data. What we could do, however, is put a giant JSON file in our GitHub repository, load it and pass it on the client. But then we would have to load the file every time someone goes on the website, even though they do not need all of the data. And that really defeats the purpose of a database altogether. But storing all of the data in one single file might not be that bad of an idea after all. There's one database in particular that got a lot of attention in recent years. It's called SQLite and is a single file database. Even if you might not have heard about SQLite, you have definitely used it, because browsers like Firefox and Chrome use it to store configuration data. And basically every modern operating system includes SQLite by default. And it's also used for much more than storing simple configuration data. According to the Stack Overflow Developer Survey, it's actually the third most popular database behind Postgres and MySQL. Interestingly enough, it is also the default database for two of the most popular backend frameworks, Ruby on Rails and Django. Now you might be wondering, why do I even need a database in the first place? So I had this idea for a little project. There are those websites that list historic events that happened in the past on this exact day of the year. Well, I want to do something like that, but instead of historic events, it shows the weather for the current day in the past years. As it turns out, the weather is actually very different all over the world all the time. So the website actually needs to show the weather of your country. And there are quite a lot of countries, and quite a lot of days, which is actually quite a lot of data. The good news is, however, that there are public weather datasets that date back to as far as 1833, and I will use those as a basis for my SQLite database. So surely we can just download the dataset and start sending the queries to get back just the data that we want. Well, unfortunately, after converting the dataset into our SQLite database, the database was pretty big, 2 GB big, which is a real problem because the maximum file size that you can publish on GitHub Pages is 1 GB. So I tried my best with my rusty SQL skills and filtered out all the data that I did not need from the database, until it got down to a somewhat reasonable size. If you ever find yourself in a similar situation, don't forget to use the vacuum command. It makes sure that all of the junk that you just removed from the database is actually removed from the file as well. And it frees up so much space. Our database finally has just the data that it needs, but how do we access it now? One solution could be SQLJS, which is a JavaScript library that allows us to use SQLite databases right within the browser. We can just query the database like we would with any other SQL database, but we would have to load the entire database first, which is still an extremely large file. And if we did that, we could have gone with the JSON approach all along. There has to be a better solution. After all, we only need a small portion of the database actually loaded. So what if we can just load those chunks that contain the data that we want to display? That's what a German developer thought in 2021 as well, and created a fork of SQLJS called SQLJS-HTTPVFS. And I promise you, this name will make more sense in a second. This library makes sure that only the parts of the database that are actually needed are loaded from the server. So how does it do that? What usually happens when we want to download a file is we send an HTTP request and we get back the entire file, which in our case is way too big. But an HTTP request does not have to fetch an entire file. If we add an HTTP range header to our request, we can request just a certain part of the file. That is, if the server supports the range header, but most of them do and Guthub Pages does as well. So we don't have to load our entire database anymore, which is huge, but how do we know which parts we need to load? SQLJS-HTTPVFS uses a virtual file system to keep track of that. Every time that we try to access the database, for example by executing a select query to get back some data, we try to read a certain range of the SQLite file. But instead of reading from the actual file, we read from a virtual file system. The virtual file system then figures out if the data is already loaded or if it has to load the data from the GitHub Pages web server. And if it does, it uses the HTTP range header to load just the part of the file that is actually needed. Obviously, that leads to some overhead, first from the SQLite database structure and second from the HTTP requests. But it also means that we do not need any server-side computing. With a regular backend, we would need some sort of server that connects to the database, queries the database and formats the data to send it back to the client as an HTTP response. But this way, we do not need any of that. Just some statically hosted files. When I first added the implementation to my project, I was really excited because it looked like everything was just working out of the box. But then I looked into what was actually loaded. As it turns out, it just loaded the entire database in chunks, which could have been avoided if I actually read the README of the project beforehand. Note that this entire thing only works well if your databases and indexes are structured well. Turns out, if you don't set any indexes at all, it simply loads everything. Indexes should be used with every database, but it is especially important here. If you don't know what indexes are, they are a way to optimize the speed of your database for things that you search for on a regular basis. For example, if you have a database column where it stores the country and you search for the country a lot in your queries, you should create an index for that country column. After creating a few indexes, it actually loads a lot faster and a lot less data, so I can finally start to build my project. Let's actually create the site. We can just query the last 5 years now and show data like temperature, rain, snow and sunshine statistics. But there's a lot more data in our database. So let's also add a chart that displays the entire history and filters out just the current day. And we should also add some averages because honestly it's still quite a lot of data to look at. This website adapts to your current location and the current day, and it will only load the data that is actually needed from the server. All of that without any server-side computing, hosted only with static files on GitHub Pages, and all of that completely for free. So that's all really cool, but there are obviously a few downsides to this approach as well. First of all, you cannot write to this database. I mean, you can, but you have to redeploy the entire project to update the database, which is probably the worst write speed that you've ever seen. But if your main concern is reading various data from a database, this is actually a reasonable approach, with basically no maintenance and no SQL injections. Now, GitHub Pages comes with its own limitations as well. I already went into the 1 GB file size limits, and there are a few more of them. You can only use GitHub Pages for public repositories unless you have a GitHub Premium plan. There's a 100 GB traffic soft limit and you are not allowed to use GitHub Pages for certain commercial projects. That being said, GitHub Pages is not the only way to host static sites. There are actually quite a lot of options out there and you can even use a CDN directly. While Cloudflare unfortunately has a history of breaking HTTP range headers for large files, CDNs like BunnyCDN explicitly support them and allow for cheap hosting of static files as well. When doing those videos, I get asked a lot, how much time do you spend on creating them? So for this one, I track the entire time using an open source time tracking tool that I'm co-creating called SolidTime. I'll have the stats on screen right now, and if you're looking for a time tracker for your freelance or agency work, check out SolidTime on solidtime.io. You can also check out the final website on onthisday.bufferhead.com to see the weather history for your country in the past. Special shout out to SQLJS-HTTPVFS for creating this amazing concept. I'll have the GitHub repository as well as the announcement blog post linked in the description down below. See you in the next video.